Okay, so we'll cover the basic of what we need to develop and extend the CiviCRM. So I'm going to talk about, extension, how to create an extension, how to use hooks and APIs, and a few more examples of things you can do easily. So I've been doing CV stuff for the past 9 years. We didn't have any extension, and I've learned the hard way. If you have to customize, use extensions. It takes a bit longer to make it as an extension, but at least it will go through, or it should go through way more easily if you wrap what you need as an extension. Because otherwise you will be fighting at every upgrade, and so you will not upgrade your CiviCRM core and the security issue and so on. So really, if you need to do something custom, first try to convince your user that they don't need it. If you fail, then develop it as an extension. And if you want to do code and that's not an extension, that's because you want to contribute back to the core and that's something you need to modify in the core. Otherwise, extension. Okay? So we are going to start with civics. I don't know if you've heard about it, any of you? Okay. Show some examples of API, how to use hooks, and a last one that's an extension, CVisualize, that make it easier to create extra reports and fun things. So, on your CiviCRM, have you all set up to be able to install and enable extensions? Okay. Okay, let's start with the basic. That's the starting point. You need to do two things to be able to use an extension, and so to be able to use your own extension and develop it as well. You need to configure to say where in which folder do you put the extensions, and the other one is where is the URL to access the resources like the style sheet and the JavaScript. So that screen is really small. Okay, I'll change here, then show you. So that's two things in the system settings. I need to connect to the internet. That will work way better. What's the password again? Welcome.
123.
So yeah, two things, change the setup, saying configure, saying the URL where you put the extension is there. Okay. So yeah, two things. One is to say the extension directory is there, and the other is the URL to access the style sheet and JavaScript is there. And that's install an existing extension and check out if it works, because obviously if you cannot get CiviCRM working with existing extension, having your own will be a bit more painful. Okay, and let's go and see that. Okay, so I put them here, but doesn't matter, you put them wherever you want. And every extension is a separate folder. And within that, you have a couple of files. The most important one is the XML that defines what the extension is, what version of CiviCRM you need, where to download it, and so on. And then various other folders where you put the template, where you put the JavaScript, where you put the PHP. All of that is painful to create manually. Thankfully, you have a tool called Civix that takes care of that. So check out on the wiki how to install that. That's two lines. And Civix has several commands. And one of them is to generate a new module. So you say Civix generate module, you give the name you want, and it will take care of creating the folder and creating the XML files. And then you have your space so you can create your extension. And I will fight for the next 2 hours with the screen because I cannot show you anything. And the only thing you need to give is the full name. So if you install an extension, that's always org.civicrm.something or your own organization. And it will generate the folder. So that would be, for example, so it creates the minimum things you need. So the folder, the XML that will define what it is, and the main file that defines all the hooks. Will go into the details of that. And you go into the XML and you update it, saying, this is the name. Basically, every time you have fixme is where you need to put what your extension is doing, the description, the license, and where to put it. Pretty much everyone now puts that on GitHub, and that's way easier to find. And if you want to share your extension, it's way easier to do that if you're on GitHub. Okay, so that's the first file you need to modify, saying what you have and describe what's your extension. And the second one is the main file that will contain all the hooks. Do you know what the hook is? Okay. So that's the main way CiviCRM interact with external code, and that hooks are bits of code that are called every time you do something, every time you display a page, or every time you install an extension, or every time you enable that extension, or every time you create a contact. Pretty much every time CiviCRM does something, it will call one of these hooks. And that's where you can plug your own feature within the framework of CiviCRM. So the example I've done, let me show you the example first. So what we are going to play with today is a very too small screen. That's to add that when you see a contact summary, we are going to have an extra block to see the group the contact belong to, and to have a feature so you can easily add that contact to the group. And so that the goal is to say how to modify an existing page to add that extra bit, and how to develop a feature. If you click on there, you have the list of groups, and you can click on the group, and it adds automatically the contact to that group. Okay, so that's the main extension we are going to try to develop together. And so here we have that extension that does that. The first step is we need a hook to say every time there is the contact summary page that's displayed, we want to add that bit of template. Okay? So that extension is called group to summary. It's on GitHub, you can fetch it, but the goal is that we try to build it together this morning. So the info, this is what it does, the description, this is where you find it on GitHub and so on. And the magic is in that file. So that hook, CiviCRM underscore summary, so the syntax is always the same for the hooks, for any of these hook functions. That's the name of your extension, underscore, CiviCRM underscore, and the specific hook. So this one would be called when you change the configuration, this one will be called when you display the summary of the contact. And you have plenty when you display a page, when you create something on the database, when you save from a form, and so on. So you go on the wiki, you have a long list of all the hooks, and pick up the one you need. And if you don't find it, go on SourceForge and ask, saying, okay, I want to modify that part, which hook should I use? Okay? So this one is when you display a contact summary. And the only thing I do is to say, add an extra template in the page body. So in the body of the page, when you display the summary, use the normal feature of CiviCRM to display the summary, and then add the content of that extra file. So the way we do it for displaying the block is we don't try to modify directly the summary and say, there, put the list of the groups the contact belong to. We put that at the bottom of the page, and then we use JavaScript to move that content inside of the second column on the contact summary. Clear so far? You're going to do it in a few minutes. Okay. Be clear. Okay. And so the template group summary is just the list of groups and we'll go into the details later on. But so far, you just take whatever is in the template and put it at the bottom of the page. Okay, I would suggest that you start trying to use a CiviCRM, generate an extension, random one, and put in the contact summary a bit of HTML template at the bottom. Okay? Oh, you don't have laptops and you want me to continue? You don't have power. Okay, do you want to try to do it or we continue?
I don't have the command line access.
Okay. Okay, then maybe we continue and go slowly through the code. But that's clear so far, saying that the easiest way to modify an existing page is to add a bit of extra template at the bottom of the page and create the content there and then use JavaScript to move it where you want inside of the page.
Yeah, I've got a couple of questions.
Yeah, sure.
One is there a tool that makes it easy to find out which books to use? I know you talked about going to a website or asking on the forum community. Is there not a tool that can show you where you need to?
The wiki is fairly decent. We can have a look.
Xavier, that's fine.
Okay, then.
The other thing I wanted to ask was, what's the reason for putting it at the bottom and then moving it to JavaScript rather than putting it in place, in the right place straight away?
It tend to be easy. I mean, again, depending what you want to do, but it tend to be easier not to mess too much with the HTML generated directly by CiviCRM because they might change the layout between versions. They might, for instance, move the columns. The CiviCRM contact summary has been changing a fair bit between versions. So it tend to be more stable and robust to say, put the HTML at the bottom and then use JavaScript to change the content within the page where you want it.
So if you've got lots of that, does that affect the page
over time? It's probably adding a few milliseconds, but no, I mean that's...
Mm-hmm. For an element to appear, then you end up having to put delays in to sort of hope that all these various bits of JavaScript have moved stuff around, like, and finished. Especially the bits where it includes loading via Ajax or something,
yeah,
in order to display the page. Like, it's not like after a result of an interaction, but I think it's worth keeping that in mind and making sure that when you, if you do that, that it works in a satisfactory way. Because the other way, is to take a copy of the core template and squeeze your stuff in there. But as Xavier says, like, that means every time you upgrade, you have to see if that core template changed and update it.
So yeah, to clarify, I try to avoid using Ajax to load extra information. So for instance, for the list of group the contact belong to, I will not use Ajax to get that list, but I will load it and put it at the bottom of the page. So the only thing you do on load is move the content at the bottom of the page and put it in the right place within. So that's a few milliseconds. That's not an extra request to the server. So it does that. Okay, I don't remember how I do it, but it does add the HTML. Do you know how to use, do you know what the API is and what you can do with that? Cool, one doesn't. Two. Okay. Okay. So yeah, the API allow you to read pretty much any content that's somewhere in CV. And you can use that via Ajax or REST interface or PHP. And what we are doing here is to read it directly from Smarty, so from the template language. And so what we do is to use that syntax saying, get all the groups for that contact. And by default, what it does is get a JSON that contains all that information. Okay, JavaScript, do you know how to make anonymous functions and avoid polluting the global namespace? Or that's... Okay, that's something worthwhile discussing then. So first thing, if you do JavaScript within the template, you have curly brackets. And it's the same curly brackets as used by Smarty. So you will be fighting Smarty that's tried to read JavaScript as if it were a command for them. And so the trick is to put literal, saying that everything that's between that and that, it's not for you, it's JavaScript, don't touch. So that's what I do. Everything that's the JavaScript is outside, or even the CSS is outside of Smarty. Don't try to read it, and that's not for you. That's JavaScript or CSS code. Okay. And the best practice is to say everything you do, you wrap inside of an anonymous function. So you avoid creating global variables. So everything you do is within that function. So you don't mess around and you don't risk having conflict with other extensions that are calling the variable group as well. So say, okay, this function is going to use three variables, the contact ID that's displayed, data that contains the list of groups the contact belong to, and TS that's used to make the translation. We're not going to cover that this morning, but if you want to have multilingual extensions, you use that helper function that allows you to translate the static text. Okay? So you say, okay, everything I need is there, that's the variables I need. And at the bottom you say, okay, the contact ID comes from there and the data come from there. And the tool to translate come from there. So that's what you do. So you call it and say the first parameter is the contact ID. This comes from Smarty. So that's one of the assign variables that you have within the template. The second one comes from the API, and that's fetching the list of groups the contact belong to. And the third one is a helper for the translation. Again, we are not going to cover that this morning. Okay? And so the generated code is contact ID will be contact number 3. The list of groups the contact belong to will be in the JSON. And with that, you can create the JavaScript you want to say, take the list of groups, create a string with that, put that string in the field where you display the list of groups, and that's it. Okay? So far, so good. And so that's where the code is. First, trying to be a bit robust, saying, I know where I want to put the list of groups, which is above where you put the contact type in the right-hand column. If I don't find it, scream, oh, something wrong. And that means that something has changed the layout. And I wrote that extension first time for a training 3 or 4 years ago, and it so far hasn't been broken. So it kind of works to put that in extensions. Okay, and then what I do is take the HTML block that I've wrote, that I put at the bottom of the page, and move it, saying, put it in the right-hand column just before the list of contact types. Okay? Then, so the API returns the list of groups, and I take them, make an array with that, and put them into the content of the list of groups. Make sense so far? Yes, no, maybe. Okay, cool. And that's it. Half of the work is done. So you bit of HTML, what you want to modify, bit of JavaScript to make the content, and move it where you want to display it. And that's it. That's something that's clear for you. You have examples of, I don't know if you had specific needs on what you wanted to do and extend on CV. Does it help on how you could use that? So this one is, that was the example I was showing earlier on, saying that in the contact, okay, again, small screen, hard to see anything, but in the contact summary, normally you have the tags and contact type, but you don't have that block that display the group the contact belong to, and that extension does that. So the bit of JavaScript, the bit of HTML is group and an empty space. And then the JavaScript we were saying is take the list of groups, make that string, put it there, and then move all the HTML to say put it at the top of the column. Thank you. Yes, it helps. And that technique works pretty much for every page. So the hook we use, the contact summary hook, is used only when obviously you display the contact summary, but there is another hook page that's called pretty much every time you display a page.
What about tpl.extra files? Is that, I've used those in the past, and now I'm a bit confused as to when you'd use the hook to add in an extra bit template and when you'd use that tpl.extra file.
Okay. Do you know what that TPL extra file is? Okay, so the easiest way to customize CiviCRM is to say I have extra templates, and based on the name of the file, so that would be like contact-summary.extra.tpl, it will automatically add it. So instead of having to create your extension and having the bit of PHP code that says take that template and put it at the bottom, it would do that automatically. So in theory, it's slightly more convenient. In practice, that's really difficult to share the result because that's not nicely packaged.
That's what's happening. You can't put an extra TPL file in an extension. Is that right?
You would need to manually add it. That's the two line of PHP that I was showing. And the other problem with the TPL extra is that you cannot have two extra. So if I have my extra that says add that group and you have your extra that says add the list of events, then we are competing and one of us will win and you will not have both. If you put that into an extension, then that's easy to have as many extra TPL bits you add. And again, that's one line of PHP that says, okay, now that you're displaying the contact summary, take that template and shove it at the bottom of the page. And yes, I've done that through dot extra, and the problems I describe, it's something I've experienced.
Yeah, I think I forgot that thing about extra TPL.
No, I wouldn't. Again, the cost and the time you spend writing an extension is, with Civic, that's fairly easy. Civic generate a new module that will create all of that. And then you have two lines of PHP that says, take that, when you are displaying that page, take that template file and put it at the bottom of the page. So yeah, that's half an hour extra, and that's way easier to share, way easier to install, disinstall, because if you have dot extra, every modification you have is put in the same folder, and that's really hard to know which one does what, when, and if you have a new installation of CiviCRM where you just want that bit, but not that bit, it's really messy. And extra thing, if it's an extension, that's way easier to share. If it's something that generic and someone else in the community could benefit from, that's way easier to say, okay, that's the extension, install it and enable it and it will work. As opposed to say, create the folder, put that template, check that the template is not already, and so on. Okay.
I've just taken over the administration of the site.
Mm-hmm.
And somebody else has installed it and set it all up, and I've just got to start looking at it now. And on it is the group 2 summary. It's on there, we're using it.
Okay.
So there you go, you already use it on our website.
That's some part of the funny part of sharing an extension. That's something I wrote for a training or a demo a couple of years ago. And then some people start to use it for real, and it was not meant to. Now it works. And now you have a new version that's using the new API format that I'm going to present now. It was from last night, so might have missed the update. Okay, I cheated a bit when I said I didn't change it since the past 3 years. I changed it last night. But it was still working. Well, as you know, you are using it. Okay. So we are using Smarty and the API to fetch that list of group. And so the benefit is, as you were saying, for the speed of load, all that is already in the page. And the only time spent is format it properly and move it in the right place, so that's a few milliseconds. For the tests, it might be a problem, but for the end user, it's not an issue at all. As opposed to the next step, which is, if I click here, I will load all the groups, and here I need to do an AJAX call and contact the server and get that list of group. And I mean, here I'm locally, so that's obviously faster, but it might take a bit longer. So that's something. If it's something I display 100% of the time when you load the page, like the list of group, I do that in Smarty on PHP, so that's already loaded. If it's something where the user click to get that extra information, then that's fine to do that with Ajax call. Okay, so the next step is when you click here, query the server, get the list of all the existing groups, display them, and if you click to one of them, then add the contact to that group. And display that message that say that's been added.
Can I ask about that? You're using an information pop-up there, which it's not immediately obvious to the end user that this is where they can actually select what the group is. It looks like it's providing them with information, like help text or something.
Yes, UI is not ideal, I agree. Yeah.
Would there be a better way of displaying that?
I'm sure there is. I don't have one on the top of my head, but do you?
You could just build a form that pops up using that. Because the Ajax stuff has functions built in to pop up a window in front of it anyway. So you could build a test form and pop it up. I think it's just in the alert because it's probably a bit quicker. To
yeah, that's... that's.
Put an info box in the corner, but if you were building a production thing, yeah, you might want to do it.
Yeah.
Yeah, the main.
I mean, if you've only got two or three users who would be changing that because at the moment you're CiviCRM users, then it doesn't take long to teach them. And if it's going to be
I mean, the main reason I used it because I wanted to show you how to use it from the user point of view. And yeah, that's not clear at all that you can click on the on that to get a list. Did you know? On
I didn't know you could
have
done that.
See? My point.
Why have you got a comma at the beginning? Because you join the groups with the comma, so the comma should be between the groups. Why do you get an extra comma at the beginning? You don't need it. It's probably a group without a comma. Right. That's what it is, group.
Yeah, it might be an empty group somewhere, or pull request welcome. Okay, and so the second part is when you click on the label groups, open that pop-up, fetch the list of groups that exist, and display them. So that's another way to call the API. That time it's Ajax and say get the list of groups. And the false is don't display any message when that's done, because by default it puts a done or something on the message. And the dot done is what is called once you loaded the data from your server. So data contains the list of groups, and I build the HTML to display the list, that list. And that's the magic command, crm.alert, that display that group. And extra param, what type, so if you want an alert info, so that's the icon you want. And if you want it to close automatically after a while, or if you leave it always open. to do it properly, I should have tested if I receive an error or not. I assume I received the list of groups and I display it, but I should have tested if data.error is there, and in that case, display an error message.
Or if there's no groups. Or if there's no groups.
Oh, if there is, yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, clear so far? And the last bit is to say, if you click to one of on one of these groups, then add the contact to that group. So the way I built the HTML is to put a data ID and put the ID of the group within that, so that's easier to fetch it later on. So say, okay, when you click on it, take the ID from that data ID, take the name of the group from the HTML that's displayed, call that API saying that group contact is the one that, well, makes the link between the contact and the groups, saying create a new one, say the group ID is the ID I just fetched, the contact ID is the contact ID, the parameter we got at the start, and this is the message I want to display when it's done, added to group plus the name of the group. Oh. And the last part is when that, beside displaying that message, that the little green thing on the top right corner that flashes a few seconds, modify the list of groups and add the group we just added. Yeah. Okay. Make sense so far? So yeah, the last thing is you can translate, but I don't know if you develop your own extension for your own organization, probably not something you're going to use. But you can translate all the static text. So this one would be the, what did I do? I didn't use it, maybe.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Add to group, and that would allow me to translate that and have resources to translate that into different languages. Yes, so when you do the your own translation in JavaScript, you specify this is the namespace. And then if that extension is public, you can put that into TransFX to manage the translation, or find someone else that manages the translation for you. So we have a big chunk of everything that is extension that can be translated by someone, by anyone in the community. And if you do that, you have a bit of code to install to generate automatically the file that extracts all the TS static strings and put them in the right POMO file, so you can upload that. Mm-hmm.
Does that include all of the extensions as well?
Is that by default or not? I have to check. I think you download them. I don't know. I'll have to ask. Yeah, we can ask that. at the break. So here we have everything we saw for that extension that add the group. The last step is to publish it and share it with the community. And so that just you go to cvcrm.org, the extension, and you submit a new one. So in my extensions does that, and you can find it in that repository in GitHub. And one of us in the community will check if you consider that's public and ready to be shared. We'll check the extension and approve it, and so everyone can automatically download it from the CiviCRM. So if you use GitHub and that you have specified that your extension is on GitHub, you just have to tag the release on GitHub with that version 1.3, and every night, I think that's daily, it will fetch all the existing and check is there a new tag, and automatically prepare what's needed for the distribution.
So isn't this unsafe to write a CV extension if it gets accepted and then just in the version upgrade just get automatically?
Well, if you install an extension, by definition that's unsafe and you need to trust what that extension does. We don't do any automatic update. But yes, I could have this night put something silly in that extension and wait until you do the update and laugh.
That goes to CiviCRM as well, which brings in a lot of external libraries and things. So I mean, that's why there's those sort of automatic updates. And if there was a new version of an extension, you'd normally sort of check through the code, make sure that check the changes.
Basically, there's community oversight
on it. Well, yeah, when you publish the extension, but if you would want to upgrade, then still, you would still check. I think what changed, or you just trust the developer. If you trust them enough to install it in the first place.
Yeah, but as a community, as a project, there's no effort. Everyone is on their own to check whether this. Going to release this minor patch level release.
I don't know if there's any sort of formal peer review around extensions. That would be up to the extension.
But I have a second one, no?
5 minutes.
Okay. But I have the second slot, or is that the end of everything?
No, you've got a second slot.
Okay. Oh, good.
She's just saying 5 minutes till we can go out and have more coffee.
But yeah, you're right, because that's what happened recently with an open source component that's used in loads of places is it got malware in it unbeknown to the author, and then it got distributed out to everywhere, and it was a really big thing. So it's not just trusting the developer, it's like trusting the developer and trusting the security of that developer's GitHub account, I suppose. So yeah, it's worth knowing that.
But I mean, that's not something that's specific to CVs. Yeah. That's every time you have a lot of contributors, like Node.js had one problem with one of the modules that was, in that case, that was deleted and it impacted.
But also, I mean, you're making it easier for the end user to install an extension. They might not understand anything about the code at all, but they can just sort of click.
No, and I mean, on my project on Node.js, I have no clue on any of the code I install in one of the dependencies because I trust, and maybe I shouldn't, but I mean, more seriously, yes, it's a complex problem, and we won't have the resource to check. So there is a bit of trust and a bit of, maybe one of us will have a look at what's the new version and what it does, and if there is anything buggy or fishy, one the others. as CiviCRM.org, we still have the option to disable an extension saying, oh, no, this one went rogue. We don't want it anymore, and prevent the automatic distribution. But we rely on the community to spot that if it's through the update. For the first time, we get a new extension before considering it stable enough to be distributed automatically to all of the install. We have a bit of looking at the code, looking at the features, trying to test it. And I mean, so far, almost all the contributors we probably knew, met in CiviCon, they came at a sprint, they've been there around for a while. So that trust was built.
We could do some way for a user review of extensions that would, I guess I'm thinking a bit like the Google Play Store or something, but you know, when, you know, and people using it can say, yeah, this is great, you know, I don't know, it doesn't have to be 5 stars, but it could be a 5-star rating, and then at the point of logging that's logged which version they're using, then that might help when you're looking at extensions, because sometimes I look at extensions and think, that says it works from 4.6, probably works from 4.7, they just haven't updated it. Like, but then there's not really, I think you can sometimes see how many people have downloaded it, is that right?
Yeah, so the only real measure that we have is how many people downloaded it or installed it. That's not recall if it's downloaded or installed. So you have that as kind of measure of popularity and assumption. If it's popular, it's good, which might be a wrong one.
I mean, WordPress plugins do that, don't they, with sort of people rating whether they work with certain versions. So maybe that's something worth recommending to the extensions working group.
Yeah,
to develop the extension showcase on the website.
I presume that would make it a lot more complex.
My version is this, it works.
Now we're onto new ideas, and if you could register your email against your use of that extension in a way that you say, yes, I would like to know about any upcoming changes that are important. Because I've worked with Beta on developing the MailChimp integration extension. One of the things that's going to happen at the end of this year is MailChimp expiring their API that the currently published extension uses. So I developed a new version of the extension that uses the new one, but it includes some backwards incompatible changes. But you will have to, users of the extension will only have until the end of December when MailChimp turn it off to install the upgrade. After that, it won't work, like if they haven't done that, because there's only this window where you can migrate the data from the old to the new API. Now, it'd be really great if, you know, because we've got no way of telling all the users of the current MailChimp integration thing that there's an important thing coming up and you need to consider updating. You need to do that before the end of the year. Otherwise, you know, it's going to break. So that would be a good thing too.
So, one of the... we were thinking about, you know, the community message that you have when you load a CV. So right now, that's the same message for everyone. But that's something we were thinking about, being able to tailor, saying that we only want to display that message for those that have that extension enabled. Yeah. I mean, but yeah, again, problem of trust. Saying that then some random developer from random extension can push whatever message they want.
May I give you a bit of feedback for this particular group to summary extension? So on the website we're on, we've got maybe about 25 groups. I'm a member of 10 of them, 15, but you produce the full list. So it might be worth removing, you know, when you say add to a group, produce a full list of 30 odd groups. It might be worth removing the groups that I'm already a member of.
I mean, again, that extension, I don't think I'd use it anymore anywhere. That's really something I brought. But again, it's on GitHub. If you fix that and do a pull request, more than happy to take it and create a new version and push it so everyone can benefit. And joke aside, this one I don't think I ever had. I'm just amazed that someone else is using it already. But on quite a few extensions I shared, I had external contributors that came, oh, it doesn't work with the latest version of Civi, or oh, there is that feature that could be useful, and that pushed it, and then everyone benefits. So that's one of the other benefits of using extensions over having your .extra TPL in your corner, then more people can more easily contribute. So that will be another extension showing how to create a page or to create a new API and or to extend CV's ULI, so having kind of report data viz. But yeah, basically that's the same kind of space and looking through the code. So if you want to check GitHub and see what's done, that's you can check another session. But you're more than welcome to stay, that's all. Tim, we had a question about how to communicate, for instance, when the MailChimp extension is not going to work anymore. Is there any way for a developer of an extension to push a message to all the installs that use it? Is that, yeah.
MailChimp changed, deprecating their old APIs, and so they've got three versions, and they're only going to support version 3 from 2017. I said, I've worked with Vader on the MailChimp integration extension, and that started off using the earlier MailChimp API.
Off the top of my head, I don't know if our communication channel supports that. I know that we can target messaging based on the
points
that are used, so the city event versus city mail, but I don't know about the extensions.
Okay.
Worth
doing a global post about
it.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind having it on my dashboard
when
I
look at it.
Good channels would be the blog and the developer list.
Yeah, for some major change and major extension, it makes sense. If it's a random one that's used by 50 persons, less useful to make a blog post for everyone.